Welcome to Ring of Fire. I'm Mike Papantonio, and here's what's happening tonight. The Republican culture war was dealt a huge blow when a judge announced that the only indictments in the Planned Parenthood video saga would be the conservative filmmakers. Interesting story. And young voters love Bernie Sanders, but they aren't fans of the American-style capitalism. We'll bring you the details on tonight's backstory. That's what's coming up. Just remember, you just stepped in to the Ring of Fire.
There's been zero warming, none whatsoever.
I'm running for president of the United States.
Congress declares war, not the president. Start with the countries that are burning our flags.
We regret these errors and apologize.
We apologize.
We apologize.
And apologize.
This is good news, people.
Well, Farron, I guess we ought to chum up the anger with the Hillary fans and actually go as far as actually reporting news about Hillary. God forbid we should actually talk about what's going on with Hillary Clinton without her Hillary bots becoming so angry because we've actually reported the news. But part of the news today, Hillary Clinton gets $13 million from the healthcare industry. And she's out there saying the single payer is impossible, it'll never come to pass. And because of that, Bernie Sanders is a left-wing socialist, and he's going to destroy the entire thing that we have in place under Obamacare. What's your take on it?
Well, you know, this is just the latest in the long line of attacks on Bernie Sanders for being too pie in the sky. How dare you dream? You know, you're saying that we can make America better. You're aiming too high. Lower your standards there a bit, Bernie. But this latest Hillary story, it's exactly what we've come to expect in this Citizens United era of the United States. Look, $13 million from the healthcare industry, and suddenly she decides that, you know what, single payer is a horrible idea. Well, 24 years ago, she's telling us single payer is the only way.
Well,
that is the only way to have healthcare.
That's what I was going to raise. This was her idea to begin with. I guess maybe that's before she got her $13 million from the healthcare industry. But the point is this. I think the problem that we're running into with Democrats right now, and full disclosure, I'm not a Democrat, I'm not a Republican, and I want to say this to the Democrats. When you get to the point to where you are upset that somebody is reporting the news and might hurt your candidate, the system is broken. Like this next story, the story with Chamber of Commerce, the lobbyist, Tom Donahue, for God's sakes, Darth Vader himself, says that Clinton is going to support TPP after the election. Well, don't you think voters would want to know that? This is Tom. This is the top guy with the Chamber of Commerce. It is as if they've sat and talked about it. They've contemplated this issue, and Clinton has assured him that she's going to vote for TPP, even though she says, I don't know what she says half the time. It's almost not clear. When I go back and look at her earlier statements, it's almost as if she never comes out and says, I'm not going to support it. I don't know where she stands on this, but this is helpful information, don't you think?
Well, it is. And Tom Donahue is a guy who does have his thumb on the pulse of American politicians. He understands exactly who is going to do what because he's already paid everybody off. He knows exactly who's going to deliver for him and who can't be purchased. So when he makes this statement that, look, I have no doubt Hillary Clinton is going to support TPP if she ever becomes president, that's his way of, you know, kind of with a wink and a nod saying, look, don't worry about it. I know exactly what's going to happen. And again, it's because he does. The Chamber of Commerce has been, you know, operating behind the scenes for decades. It's only recently, the last 10 years, that people have started to pay attention to this. It's an issue you and I have talked about for years.
Farron, I just got back from Malaysia and Indonesia, everywhere from Singapore to Vietnam to Cambodia to Thailand to Hong Kong. And you know what they're all waiting for? TPP. And their talking point about TPP is we're going to get a bunch of jobs over here. That's right. They're going to get a bunch of jobs, and the United States is going to lose record numbers of jobs. Now, if we're honest about it, and if we don't play dunce Democrat, where we can't be honest, where we can't actually report a story if we're honest about this story, here are the moving parts. A, Bill Clinton gave us CAFTA and NAFTA. B, Hillary Clinton has been completely, just totally evasive about her position on TPP. C, Tom Donahue, the guy for the Chamber of Commerce that they've put millions of dollars into TPP, is saying, you know what? Hillary's with us. As soon as she becomes president, we're going to get exactly what we want. And as soon as that happens, we're going to see an exodus of jobs. When I was over in Indonesia, they're all waiting for it. They all know the issue. They know what it's going to mean in jobs, and they know we're going to lose jobs over here in this country. Nevertheless, this is something that Tom Donahue types want. They want to be able to go to a place like Indonesia where they don't have to pay any salaries, they don't have unions, they don't have any benefits at all, and they don't have to worry about competition because there are so many people lined up for that job that they can fire at will, and it's a Saipan kind of mentality. That is what your Democrat types are afraid to hear me say. They can't stand the idea that I'm sitting here telling the truth, reporting news about Hillary Clinton, because they don't want to hear it. And if I hear one more time, oh, my God, you're going to help the Republicans win. Really? Do you think your candidate is so weak that if she gets the nomination and I'm critical in that process, that the Republicans are going to win? What is your take on that? I know you've put up with it for years as I have. We get the emails, we get the calls, we get the letters. How dare Ring of Fire talk about Hillary Clinton? It is our job. How about that?
That really is the perfect response to it. But, you know, we go online, we get labeled as the Bernie bros and, you know, oh, they just don't want a woman to win. And that could not be further from the truth.
Oh, my God.
It's the fact
I'd vote for Elizabeth Warren in a second.
Absolutely.
Doesn't have anything to do with women. It has to do with the woman that stands up for progressive values, that cares for middle America in a way that we're going to see an impact.
Here's the thing, too. You know, if you are looking at it from a gender standpoint, is Hillary Clinton the person that you want to hold that title of the first female president of the United States of America? Because once that title is given out, it can't be taken back. And that would be a horrible example, I believe. You know, she is a Republican. Look, I mean, she started her life and her career as a Republican. She changed later on down the line when her and Bill were together. But she has not given up those principles or those ideals. She's only adopted populism because she sees that it works for Bernie Sanders. She wants to do what she wants to do, which is help corporations who are going to give her money. That's what her whole career has been about.
Let me move to Debbie Wasserman Schultz, who should be gone immediately. They need to get rid of this woman. She has done more damage to the Democratic Party in her short term. And when we look back, we're going to see the damage that she has done. Now, I call it the Confederacy. Common Dreams had a wonderful article on that. I think it was John Acheson wrote it. It was called The Confederacy of Dunces, The Democratic Establishment's Assault on Sanders Begins. All right. It didn't just begin now. It began when Wasserman Schultz said, A, we're not going to create any vehicles for Bernie Sanders to get his word out there. We're not going to allow any type of meaningful debate schedule. We're going to schedule debates on Sunday night opposite the regional football game of the year. That's what this woman has done to the party, because she is so bought and paid for by the Bill Clinton Hillary camp. And it is making the Democrats look like an absolute Confederacy of dunces.
Well, in this establishment attack on Bernie Sanders, they're going after him because he personifies everything that they were afraid of. Now, it's not that they just hate Bernie Sanders. They hate Bernie. They hate Elizabeth Warren. They hate Sheldon Whitehouse, because those people understand that money in politics, allowing that corrupting influence to not only continue but to grow, That's what the establishment Democrats want to happen. But those people who actually have a conscience say, look, that's not what the American democracy is all about. And we need to change this system. And that terrifies these people. So they're willing to sell out the entire party from their seats of leadership in order to just possibly extend their political career or their personal career just a few more years, get a few more $1 million in the bank, because that's all they care about. They don't care about what they're doing.
Farron, the first time I heard Bill Clinton speak, he was still governor of Arkansas. And his speech was that we have to move to the middle. And in order to move to the middle, we have to have a bond with corporations. We have to have a bond with Wall Street. We have to have a bond with banks. I get that. But that doesn't mean we need to give away democracy to the banks or give away democracy to Wall Street. So the truth is, he started this trend. And Obama really hasn't interrupted it at all. Obama has done nothing to turn that trend around. And when Hillary Clinton gets in office, it's simply a continuation of the Wall Street Democrat where nothing changes. And that's why Acheson's story here just really caught my eye. The Confederacy of Dunces is where the Democrats won't even talk about it. And as a matter of fact, are critical of people who talk about it. Now, I mean, let's be honest. Why are young voters embracing Bernie Sanders? Why is that happening? I mean, that's a rhetorical question. I mean, is it a problem that he wants to save the planet? That, you know, that climate change matters to him? Is it a problem that he wants to take power away from Wall Street? That when Wall Street commits a crime, that you might actually put somebody in friggin' prison? I mean, is that a problem? Is it a problem that we need to get control over the division that's taken place in America between the 1% and everybody else? These are things, you got kids coming out of college, Farron, that can't get a job. You got kids coming out of college that are still having to live at home until they're 35 years old because the economy is so damn bad. But, so the question, you know, the question that's posed, why are young voters embracing Bernie Sanders but not democracy? That's kind of the end of that question. They're not embracing democracy at all.
Well, no, because democracy has never worked for them. You know, look at kids that are, you know, between the ages of 18 and 25 right now. You know, born in the later part of the 1990s, when right as the economy was doing well, but then a few years later, before they even enter grade school, the whole dot-com bubble happens. We get the crash. George W. Bush comes in, sends us, you know, straight into a recession, which only gets worse in 2007 and 2008. So these people, all they know about the political system is crony capitalism, corporations breaking the rules and never being held accountable. I mean, you know, these people, one of the first news stories they probably ever heard in their lives was about Enron. Yeah. That is the American democracy, the American system of politics that they have grown up with, and it has created this generation of cynics.
Right. They haven't seen democracy work. You're right.
Right.
They've seen us lied into a war where 500 soldiers, U.S. soldiers, are killed needlessly for no reason at all based on an absolute, utter lie. They see that. They see Wall Street committing crimes almost every day and asking the question, don't criminals go to prison when they commit crimes? They see Obama making promises to them that I want to help you with your college expenses, and now they find out that was a lie. They find out that they see energy companies that are talking about how they're so invested in the future of the planet, but in their heart they know that that's a lie as their planet melts.
Well, and they also see mass shootings happening every other day and then no action on gun control because the government's just that dysfunctional. So, you know, just add that to the list.
Yeah, I mean, it is endless. And if you are a millennial right now voting for a Republican or voting for an establishment Democrat, you are a damned idiot. That's the best way I can put it. Liberals, well, they're turning to cities to pass laws, and to spread new ideas. This is a very interesting story. They know they can't get anything done in the federal level, so they're going city by city. Tell us this story, Farron.
Well, this one's really interesting because it is true. Look, a lot of the dysfunction in Washington, D.C. is coming from Republican obstruction. These last two sessions of Congress have passed the fewest bills ever in history. So finally the liberals are
bills. You're right.
Right. So finally liberals have decided, look, if we want change to happen in this country, like raising the minimum wage, we've got to do it city by city. And that's exactly what's happening. And they look back to what happened in the 1990s with the indoor smoking bans. That wasn't a national guideline. It started because a city here and a city there, and then finally it picked up steam. They know that change can come in small increments to, you know, have this snowball effect.
Minimum wages, climate issues, yep. You name it, guns, they've all had to go to the cities to get anything done. And now there's a pushback by the Chamber of Commerce to end that. Right now there's a lobbying effort. The argument is federalism versus state rights and local rights. And right now you've got a U.S. Supreme Court, I promise you, that is going to rule in favor of the feds, and large corporations and large Wall Street. They're gonna rule for them every opportunity they can. So it's a great plan, and I'd love to see it take hold. But right now we have a Supreme Court that will deep six us. Got about a minute left. This story to me is just absolutely remarkable. Michigan officials gave bottled water to state employees months before they even let Flint residents know that their water was so full of lead that it would almost stand up on a table. They quietly give these people bottled water and just keep everything else quiet. What's your take?
Well, you know, for anyone inside the government in Michigan to say that they had no idea that things were this bad or that they would get this bad is an absolute lie, because their own assessments before they even switched the city's water from Detroit to the river, they said, no, look, this water is too contaminated, too gross, we can't do it. And then they all just kind of sat back and said, no, we're gonna do it anyway because it's slightly cheaper.
Yeah.
And so that's democracy.
Let me mention, just so our viewers know, I've been asked to handle the case up there in Flint. There is no case. And I'd love to be able to help these people, but there is nothing to do for them because there is something called governmental immunity. A guy like Snyder gets away with pure murder and nothing can be done. Farron Cousins, thank you for joining me, okay?
Thank you.
Republicans love to talk culture war issues during the campaign season, and the attacks on Planned Parenthood for the last year have given them plenty of exposure, but this is one time when everything blew up in their face. Earlier today, Farron Cousins talked with Howard Nations about this story, so let's take a look.
Howard, the whole Planned Parenthood attacks, I mean, God, we've been hearing about it for almost a year now. Republicans have been going after it. And I think one thing that's really been missed in all the shuffle is what exactly Planned Parenthood is, you know, how long have they been around, what is their importance? And I think that's something that people really need to understand before we even get into the craziness of what has happened in the last 2 weeks with them. So take us back, you know, kind of to the beginning. What exactly is Planned Parenthood's role in the United States?
That's a great question in the context of all the misinformation that's out there today. Planned Parenthood is the nation's largest women's health care provider. They provide critical and preventative health care primarily to low and moderate income women. Federal dollars that they get pay for STD screenings, for contraception, and for cancer screenings and things of that nature. Public health experts agree that Planned Parenthood helps preserve women's overall health and fertility while limiting unwanted pregnancies. By limiting unwanted pregnancies, they also do great things to reduce the number of abortions.
Well, you know, I think it's very interesting because those are things that very rarely have they been discussed. And so I guess part of the issue as well is, you know, this organization does receive funding from the government, and that's what got the conservatives all riled up about it, because according to them, according to the Republicans, the federal government is paying Planned Parenthood to go out there and just perform as many abortions as possible. Let's, you know, one right after the other, knock them out. And that's what they say. It's, you know, this massive abortion, you know, multiplex funded by the government. Is there any truth at all to anything in that statement?
Well, the Republican politicians who are saying that know better. They're either stupid or they're just lying, or both. The fact is that the government had a major problem. The cost to the government of treating and delivering the babies of unintended pregnancies, they did a study in 2006, the cost was $11 billion in 1 year. Part of the solution was to publicly fund family planning organizations such as Planned Parenthood. It saves the state and federal government $4.3 billion each year. The contraceptive use alone saves $19 billion in direct medical costs and reduces the occurrence of abortions. They do more to prevent abortions, far more to prevent abortions, than they ever do in performing abortions.
And none of the federal funding that the group receives is even allowed to go towards any kind of abortion services, correct?
Yeah, that's right. They actually, in fiscal 2014, which is the last year that we have funding information on them, they received $528 million in government funding, $305 million in non-government funding, and $257 million of that was from private donors and foundations. They received $57 million for fee from their services. The federal funding for abortions was absolutely zero. In 1976, it was made illegal to use federal funds for abortions. The abortions are only 3% of all the services that are provided by Planned Parenthood, but the Republican politicians are trying to defund the entire thing and all the other benefits that come to women from Planned Parenthood.
Because, you know, when you look at the Republican base, really, because the politicians are the ones saying it, but the Republican base are the ones that eat this up, you know, because their whole crusade has always been, let's limit a woman's right to choose what to do with her body. That's the cut and dry of it. That's exactly what they want to do. So the Republican politicians, they buy into this. And so they come out on the floor of the House. We've seen them come out during the debates and attack Planned Parenthood. So why all of the attack? I mean, I know they do it for the base, but anybody who has access to internet and a search engine can find out the truth in 10 seconds about this group. So how do these attacks continue to be successful?
Well, Republican politicians are never bothered by facts. What happened here recently to make this thing fired up so much is in 2015, the so-called Center for Medical Progress, their president, David DeLeiden, and Sandra Merritt, who was the founder of a fake tissue procurement company called Biomax, produced a group of sting videos that purported to show that Planned Parenthood was illegally trafficking in fetal tissue. Republican politicians' heads exploded. They were so happy when they saw this video. State and federal investigations began. Outrage ensued across the board. This verified all those things that they had always dreamed might be true. Republican politicians called for defunding of Planned Parenthood, and they called for grand juries and legislative investigations of Planned Parenthood's illegal activities. So far, 12 states have investigated Planned Parenthood. No evidence out of 12 state investigations that Planned Parenthood was selling or profiting off fetal tissues. The actual use, now think about this, the actual use of the fetal tissue is for medical research. They're seeking cures for healthcare issues such as Parkinson's disease, Alzheimer's, Down syndrome, cystic fibrosis, miscarriage, and other women's health issues particularly. The fetal tissue use is agreed to by the mothers. The fetal tissue research is supported by federal funds, $76 million last year. Now, the congressional investigations, the federal investigation, in addition to the 12 state investigations, the Republicans in the House, four separate investigations by Congress. No wrongdoing, no evidence of wrongdoing by Planned Parenthood. The Senator Ernst, the prominent pig castrator from Iowa, she called for an investigation by Health and Human Services. They did so. No violations of tissue laws. No violations found by the Obama administration. So finally, after all these investigations, criminal conduct was found. Among Republican politicians calling for the investigation of Planned Parenthood was Texas Lieutenant Governor Dan Patrick. Dan Patrick is a very hardcore right-wing hero of the far right-wing in Texas. Dan referred this to the Harris County District Attorney for an absolute full investigation, taking it wherever it'll go. Now, he felt pretty complacent about this since the district attorney had been appointed by Rick Perry. And she took it where it went. She took it to the grand jury, who indicted David DeLayden and Sandra Merritt of Biomax and of the Center for Medical Progress for having altered videos that had begun this whole debacle. Now, specifically, they were indicted for second-degree felony of tampering with a government record and purchase of and sale of human organs, which is a Class A misdemeanor. Now, the second-degree felony carries up to 20 years in prison.
You know, Carly Fiorina, during one of the first Republican debates, she told the crowd that she had seen these videos.
Oh, yeah.
She saw the fetus on the table. It was, you know, flailing its legs and waving its arms, and then they kill it. Even in the doctored videos, that didn't even exist anywhere. I mean, that she just made that up on the spot. But those are just the kinds of crazy, crazy talking points that Republicans are using with Planned Parenthood. And so now we're finally going to get an indictment of the people who made the films. And just in the little bit of time we have left, do you believe that will kind of stop the attacks? Or, as you've said, Republicans don't care about facts, so do you think it's just going to continue to barrel forward?
Well, they've also sued the Center for Medical Progress in California on RICO. And in addition to that, they're taking other actions to try to bring the facts of this to the public. They did a forensic analysis. They found that the tapes were intentionally deceptive. They had manipulated footage. They contained 42 instances of editing and taken out of context, and the transcripts that they released, upon which these Republicans are basing their move to defund Planned Parenthood, the transcripts did not match what was actually said on the tapes. That did not prevent Congress from passing legislation to defund Planned Parenthood, which was fortunately vetoed by President Obama. Let me mention one last thing. I know we're out of time, but there's one last thing. Instead of calling this pro-life, they should be calling it pro-birth, because they're not in favor of life, because they immediately abandon the mother and child. They attack the same people that cry out on behalf of the fetuses, immediately attack the social safety net, the food stamp program, the minimum wage. If they care nearly as much for the actual children after they're born as they claim for the fetuses before they're born, their position would be a little more palatable.
Absolutely. Howard Nations, thank you for telling us this story. It's a very important story, and I hope everyone takes the time to fully understand exactly what is happening, exactly what this group is, and who David DeLayden and his group are. This has been a disgusting story, and unfortunately, I still don't think Republicans are going to give up on it. But thank you for talking with us today, Howard.
My pleasure.
And that's all the time we have for today, but you can get more news, more videos, and commentary at our website, theringoffire.com. And don't forget to check out YouTube page at youtube.com/goleftTV. I'm Mike Papantonio, and I'm going to see you tomorrow.